Stand with me. I want us to go to the book of Jonah in the Old Testament. Praise God. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. Amen. Are you all there? Chapter 1, starting at verse 1. I'm just going to read 3 verses in your hearing. Jonah chapter 1, starting at verse 1. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise and go to Nineveh, that great city." Praise God.
Come on. Amen.
This must be just a day for. This must be that day.
Yeah.
Amen. That day that you just gonna get tried.
Right.
Amen. You know the devil didn't like the fact that we were just crazy.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
But you know what? He's a liar.
That's right.
Yes.
And still a defeated foe. Amen.
That's right.
The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to our God. You may be seated in the presence of our God. I want to talk to you this morning about the consequences of saying no to God. The consequences of saying no to God.
Right.
On last Sunday at St. Mark, I talked to you about the Great Commission, the last words that Jesus uttered before he was caught up, before he ascended back home to be with his Father. He said, "Go into all the world." He said, "And teach them all things that I've commanded you, baptizing them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit." And he said, "Lo, I will be with you always, even until the end of the age." Mm-hmm. Now that's our mandate. It's our marching orders.
Right.
Amen?
Uh-huh.
And so we should be going all the time. I told you all that last week that word "go" means as you are going. That means that all through the day you ought to be representing Jesus Christ.
All right.
Amen. That when people encounter you, they must encounter Jesus. But in our text this morning, we have a preacher, a prophet, who God gives instructions to and tells him specifically where he wants him to go. But instead of this preacher, this prophet, doing what God said to him, Jonah decided to go in the opposite direction.
Right now.
Now, if we're honest, all of us in here would have to admit that there have been times when God has told us to do something.
Yes.
And whereas we may not have come out and verbally said it, Our actions have depicted that we had a different point of view.
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
We have all done our own thing at times, in spite of knowing full well what God had already said.
All right.
The prophet Jonah was a historical character mentioned in other places in Scripture. So Jonah is not a figment of somebody's imagination. And some people would, you know, when they read about Jonah being swallowed by a fish and all these kinds of things, you know, they dismiss it as something that is a fairy tale or a story that was just told for good purposes. But the book of 2 Kings refers to him as a historical prophet. A prophet ministering to Israel in the days of Jeroboam. He is referred by the Lord Jesus Christ himself, who said, as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. That's found in Matthew chapter 12, verse 40. With these kinds of backing, there can be no doubt that the book of Jonah is historically accurate. Jonah wanted to see Nineveh destroyed. How many of you have looked at your enemies or your adversaries and wanted God to do something to them? In spite of the fact that the Lord said, love your neighbor as yourself, then he said, and even love your enemies. We have a tendency to have a different view. Amen? You know, when people you know are adversary, you don't have to ask nobody. And you see the shovel in their hand. And the ditch that they're digging has your name on it. Amen?
Right.
Have you prayed under your breath and say, God, get them? You know they ain't no good. You know they lying, cheating. God, just do what you do. Amen. If you've ever done that, you have to say that you're like Jonah. Amen?
Amen.
Jonah wanted Nineveh destroyed. Why did he want Nineveh destroyed? Well, Nineveh was a great enemy of the Jewish people. Perhaps Jonah had actually seen these cruel, ruthless, bloody Ninevites periodically coming down into his land and raiding his people. Perhaps he had even suffered the loss of loved ones at the hands of these merciless people. In the ancient world, the record for the bloodiest and most vicious kinds of cruelty belongs, perhaps, to the Ninevites. They found more incredibly ingenious ways to be cruel than any other nation that had ever lived. They were brutal and godless and sinful, and Jonah hated them. The one thing that Jonah wanted more than anything else was to see the Ninevites destroyed. Yet God had a different plan. And God tells Jonah not to go to Rome, not to go to Syria, not to go to Egypt, but to go to Nineveh. How many of y'all know that God will many times take you and direct you to the place that you would not go on your own? Sometimes God has you talking to people that if you had your rathers, you would never encounter them. Amen. God many times, don't ever say what you won't do. Because God has a way of changing plans. God has a way of redirecting trips. God has a way wouldn't go on your own.
Amen.
And so I can only imagine when God told Jonah to go to Nineveh that Jonah might have cussed. Jonah, I got a preaching moment for you. And if Jonah had any of us in him, he probably told God, hell no. I'm just going to keep it real. Jonah didn't want to go. And as a matter of fact, when God told him to go, Jonah didn't try to butter up or try. He went in the opposite direction.
Yes, he did.
Hallelujah. Nineveh was so bad until if God had just destroyed them and Jonah had read it in the USA Today, he probably would applaud it. You're good. How many of y'all have ever, you don't have to answer this, it's a rhetorical question, ever got glad from somebody else's misery? And so Jonah, when God told him to go to Nineveh, Jonah immediately said, no, I'm going to Tarshish. Now, if you look at the map, Tarshish was the furthest point in the opposite direction than Nineveh.
Good.
In other words, even if they had got the trip kind of messed up, he still wouldn't have been in Nineveh. That's how bad he didn't want to go to Nineveh. Are you getting the picture?
Right.
Now, whenever you decide that you're not going to do what God says do, everything you do is going to be down.
All right.
Some people are on a downward spiral right now because God has told them to do some things, and instead of them doing what God said do, they're going out to do their own thing.
Yep.
And when you do your own thing, there's a cost. And even when you come back to God and say, God, I'm sorry, God will forgive you of your sin, but the consequences remain.
Amen.
So sometimes what we're experiencing is not that God is mad at us, but when you plant seeds, harvest is coming. And harvest time is always greater than planting. So you can plant a few seeds, but you can get a whole crop of harvest.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
And so look at it. God told him to go to Nineveh. Jonah went down to the dock. He went down to the dock. He bought a ticket and went down into the boat. Everything you do, when you disobey God, until you get it right, it's going to be a downward spiral.
All right.
It's kind of, you all remember that scene in The Color Purple? When Mr. Head, he just has messed up and he had messed up so bad till his wife wanted to leave. And when she was on her way out, he's about ready to hit her. And she did something with her hand. I don't know what the, she did something. You don't know what. You remember that scene?
Yeah.
She said, nothing you do is going to prosper until you do it right. Yeah. Well, that's how it is when you disobey God. Everything you try to do, even the good things you try to do, won't mess up. Until you get it right with God.
Amen.
Because you can wrong people, And you can make it right, but when you wrong God, it's not going to get right on its own. Amen. You know, some people have got some stuff in their past that they have never gone back to, and they ain't right. Some people that have wronged you that you've never forgiven. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says that if you don't forgive your brothers and sisters of their trespasses, God is not going to forgive you your trespasses. Now, that means that some people have spent years in unrepentance. And you wonder why your prayers are hindered, or why the anointing is not operating fully in your life. It might be because you still hold grudges or animosity towards somebody in your past. It may be that God is trying to get you to go back and right the wrongs that have happened so that you can go forward, because you know you can't go forward until you backtrack and got things right that have been wrong in your past. Oh, somebody say
amen.
So he went down into the boat. And here's the thing about God. You can get on a cruise ship. But if you're on the outs with God, God will change the weather pattern. Amen. And God don't have to ask nobody. So he went down into the boat. Now watch this. While he's on this boat, a storm comes up. And the storm rages. Some of you all have seen cruise ships when they be out on a turbulent sea, and it looks like the sea is just tossing and turning. That cruise ship, as big as those cruise ships are, like a toy. I don't want to be on that ship.
No.
Amen. And the storm raged. And it raged, and it kept on raging, and it got worse. It got so bad, somebody say, how bad did it get? It got so bad, until everybody on the ship started to say to one another, you better pray to your God, wherever he is, because we're not going to make it. Guess where the preacher was? He down there sleeping. He's sleeping on the house with God. They went down in the boat. They say, hey, creature, you better get up and pray, because God is mad at somebody. Now give him credit. He ain't like some folk today who be looking around at everybody else wondering. But Jonah came clean. Imagine that. Jonah said, you know what? I'm the problem. You know, so many people would be so better off in churches if they would just come clean. Instead of coming dressed up, smiling, and acting like everything is all right in your life, you ought to just be honest.
Amen.
And tell God, I'm in a mess. And Lord, I came specifically for a help from you. Jonah said, I'm the problem. And you know, can you imagine people on the boat? They said, you is? Now, if you read the record, the Bible says that they tried everything to secure the boat, even after Jonah told him that he was the problem.
Right.
Here's the thing, you always know when a storm is God being. Because the more you try to make it better, the worse it gets.
Come on.
Amen. And it didn't matter what they did, the storm got worse. Finally, they looked at Jonah and said, you got to go. Oh, this is a preaching moment right here. Because see, some things in your life and some people in your life, you got to get to a point where you say, you got to go. See, I got one or two amen. Some of y'all will never prosper beyond where you are right now until you cut ties with that dead weight that you walking with.
All right.
Hallelujah to the Lamb. Some people don't mean you any good. Some people are are just like leeches. They'll suck you until they suck you dry and then leave you high and dry. Amen. You need to come to a point where you say, you know what? Can't be like it's been. You know, I got to move on. I don't mean you no harm. I'm praying for you. I hope for the best for you. But we can't walk together. Amen. How can two walk together unless they agree?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And since we're not in agreement, I'm going to go my way and you go your way. Amen.
Amen.
And so can you see them marching him to the edge of that shit? And saying, see ya. Wouldn't want to be. Now watch this. He went down to the shore. He went down in the boat. Now he's being cast down in the sea. And you know what? God could have let him drown. Just like, if we're honest, all of us in here shouldn't be here.
Right.
Amen.
Because you ain't lived that good. Not damn one of
them.
And there was stuff that you got caught up in that if it hadn't been for God's grace and God's mercy, you'd have been out of here. So the next time you think about how good God is, think about all of the stuff that God has brought you through, that in spite of yourself, God made a way out of no way. Downward spiral hadn't stopped. Because God had fashioned a fish. Jesus called him a whale. Now, you know, this is how man is. Man will look at the whale and say, how could a whale swallow the man? Listen, if God made the sea and God made the sky, if he made the celestial being, I really don't have a problem with God making a fish big enough to swallow a little creature. I mean, really? And so Jonah found himself down in the belly of a whale. Now, if you find yourself in whale's guts, that's a good place to pray. I'm just believing that. I'm just believing.
Right.
I've never been in a whale's belly. But I'm just believing that that would have been a good time to just pray. Can you see Jonah trying to find him some space and getting down on bended knee and saying, Lord, I done messed up. And you know, everybody in here, periodically, you ought to get down on your knees and say, God, I've messed up a whole bunch of times.
Amen.
And so you need to forgive me not just for sins of commission, but sins of omission.
Yes.
Things I did that I knew was wrong.
Yes.
And things that I did that I didn't know was wrong.
Yes.
Places I should have gone that I didn't go. People I should have spoken to that I didn't speak to. God, I want you to clear the slate. Because I don't want anything impeding my relationship and fellowship with you.
Amen.
Periodically, you need to do that.
Yes.
Amen. In the morning, when you wake up, I'm sure all of you all take a shower or wash up or something. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. But all you got to do is step out the house. And because you live in a dirty world, you can take a handkerchief and wipe it across your face. And guess what? It's going to be some earth on you. It's going to be some dirt on you. Because when you live in a dirty world, you will get dirty. I got good news for you. If you're a saint of God, in spite of the best you try to do, you're going to get dirty. dealing with folk, with their issues, dealing with kids, dealing with spouses, dealing with whoever you got to deal with, co-workers, you're going to get dirty.
Amen.
You're going to think thoughts that ain't God.
Amen.
Amen. You're going to want to go in directions God ain't never told you. Amen. You are going to get dirty. And so every day of your life, you need to go back to God and say, God, whatever you see in me that's unlike you, take it out. I'm not sure even, you know, I know that's the song, but I'm not even sure the Lord wants to strengthen you. He wants to be strong in himself.
Amen.
If you strong, you might try to thwart his strength. I do believe he told Paul that I'm made perfect in your
weakness.
Not in your strength. In your weakness.
Yeah.
So sometimes when we're praying to be strong, we're countering what God really wants to do, because God wants to be strong. He don't want you to be strong. You've been too strong already. Praise God. You know what God did? God gave the preacher another chance. Somebody say another chance.
Another chance.
I hear people saying that we serve a second chance God. Listen, you wore a second chance out a long time. And if God is just a second chance God, you'd be in trouble this morning.
Amen.
Amen. I would be in trouble this morning if that was just, if all God was a second chance God, I couldn't make it.
Amen.
But I'm glad that God throws our sins in the sea of forgetfulness.
Amen.
And remembers them no more. And then he puts a no fishing sign there. So anybody want to go fishing there can't. Amen?
Amen.
So God allowed the fish to regurgitate the preacher. In other words, he gave the fish an upset stomach.
Amen.
So he could throw up the preacher.
Right.
Somebody said, thank God for the throw up. I'm having fun with this. And Jonah made a 3 days journey in 1 day.
Right.
How many of y'all know you'll get in a hurry after the Lord done did what he knew? You don't have to wonder if you're going to do it. You get in a hurry to do what God said. Because God knows how to get your attention. And he knows how to redirect your mind. Amen? And so the preacher got in a hurry. And he went in a hurry to go to Tarshish. He got in a hurry to go where? Say it loud. To Nineveh. Guess what God told him to go in the first place? Somebody in here got a Nineveh God wants you to go to. And don't be trying to redirect God's plans.
Amen.
You need to redirect your plans so that you can get in a hurry.
Amen.
Go to Nineveh. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I'm not going to tell you the whole story, but let me just suffice it to say, when he got to Nineveh, he preached. And he preached a sour sermon. Some folk in churches that the preacher don't even want you to get saved.
Nope.
Some of them just doing enough just to get by. They don't care.
Amen.
If you get delivered, they don't care. If you get your answer, they just want you there, amen, to subsidize whatever they're trying to do.
All right.
So ain't much gospel being preached. Amen.
Right.
It's a whole bunch of stuff. But I know when the gospel is preached, the possibility is there for lives to be changed.
Amen.
when the gospel is preached, God is able to transform broken lives.
Amen.
Amen. So I can only imagine that when the preacher started preaching that it wasn't good. And the reason why it wasn't good was because Jonah knew God. Repeat this after me. Jonah knew God. If you study God's word, God's word will reveal his will. And if you study his will will reveal his ways. If you want to know God's ways, you got to know his will. If you want to know his will, you got to get in his word. But when you get in his word, you want to know his ways, and his ways are going to reveal his will. And Jonah knew that if God allowed him to preach in Nineveh, that the Ninevites would repent. And the preacher didn't want them to repent.
Wow.
Okay, I want y'all to get this picture.
Yeah.
You in a congregation, the preacher don't want you to repent. He tried his best not to get you to repent, but he got to preach the word because he just got out of fish guts. And so he must have said something that sounded like,
when you confess your sins to the Lord, he will forgive you.
He kind of under his breath, hoping that they didn't hear. But guess what the Bible said? They heard it. And the whole city repented.
Wow.
And you know how I know that the preacher didn't want him to repent? Because after the service, he went up on the mountaintop and blaming God for allowing them to be saved. Let me tell you what that conversation must have sounded like. Doggone. I knew if I came here, I knew if I preached what you told me to preach, that those sorry, no good rascals would repent. And look at them now. Instead of you killing them, now you done forgave them.
Woke them up.
Leave. What if you was in church and half the church was mad because you repented? Now don't tell me it don't happen. God said, You liked that plant, didn't you? You didn't plant. That's my plant.
Right, right.
That worm that ate up that plant, I put that worm there. Right. And just like I gave you shade from the hot weather, I can allow those Ninevites to be saved if I want to, because they're not your people, they're my folk.
All right.
And none of you in here has the right to be complaining about anybody that comes up in here wanting to repent. I don't care how that live.
Amen.
For as quiet as it kept, you live worse.
Amen.
In many instances.
Amen.
It's your proud, arrogant self.
Come on, Pastor.
We got to learn how to see other people in the light of our own lives. What has God saved you from?
Yes.
What were you doing when God found you? You didn't find God, he wasn't lost.
Yes.
God found you, where did he find you?
Yes.
That's right.
You need to think about it.
Thank you.
The next time somebody come in here to give their life to the Lord, don't judge them.
Amen.
Consider where you were.
Amen.
And the same God that saved you saves us. Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Now I'm almost finished, but I got to tell you the consequences of saying no to God. I'm just going to give you four things, and I'm not going to try to unpack them because I don't want to hold you too long. Amen. The consequences of saying no to God, number one is that it costs you God's presence. It costs you God's presence. Because you know, God will stop walking with you. God will just back up from you and leave you to yourself. And you don't want God to back up from you.
Amen.
Because if God ever just take a step back, you become susceptible to every weapon that the adversary has aimed for you.
Amen.
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 I need God's presence.
Amen.
I want God's presence.
Amen.
Because God covers me. He envelops me. Before the adversary can touch me, he got to first touch God. And I've come to tell you that his arms are too short to box with God. You do not want to give up God's presence by saying no to God.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
Number two, you give up God's place. Because God wanted his word to be preached in Nineveh. Amen. And the very place that he's sending you to, it is because he wants to do a work in that place. Some people complain about the job they got. Let me tell you who gave you that job. God gave you that job. He didn't give you that job for you to be going every day complaining and giving everybody else the blues because you got a job. What's the flip side of not having a job? Then if you don't have a job, then you worrying, God, I need employment. God said, I gave you employment. You went to acting a fool. Got everybody frustrated on the edge because you don't like your job. If you'd asked me about the job, I'd have gave you a different job. I didn't even want you on that job. Because your disobedience, I knew you needed a job, so I let you have that job so that you can get your butt whooped to let you know to stop leaning to your own understanding. You think God wants you to be frustrated on your job? But when you went to college, you didn't ask God what he wanted you to do. You pick something. Somebody got in your ear.
Well, you know they make a whole bunch more money. You went over to that, so you don't need to do that. You need to come over here. So you went over there. Now you're making more money, but you ain't got no peace. You ain't got no joy.
don't even come to you. You be frustrated thinking about getting up the next day. Praise God. Thirdly, you give up God's peace. God gives peace that passes all understanding. God will give you peace when everything is falling apart.
Yes, he will.
Thank you.
House falling apart. Job. Kids. Everybody just seems like they're losing their mind. And you walk in peace.
Yes.
And people be asking, how come you so calm? The peace of the Lord. Which surpasses all understanding. Will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Just because everything else falling apart don't mean you're supposed to fall apart.
Amen.
Amen. God will give you stability.
Mm-hmm.
And it gives you peace of mind in the midst of turbulence. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
And we need peace.
Yes, sir.
How many of y'all want peace in here? How many of y'all got peace in here?
Amen. Thank you.
Listen, you better, if you had to go to Walmart, I don't know if you could buy it. Because your pay scale ain't tough enough to buy peace. Amen.
Amen.
And then number four, it'll cost you your purpose. How many of y'all know that we all have a purpose?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And my purpose is not your purpose.
Amen.
But I need to work in my purpose. And you need to operate in your purpose.
Yes,
amen?
Amen.
And here's what I found out. My wife is getting ready for the kids to come home. All four will be home in November. The six grandkids will be here. Now she wants me on the edge. So told me right there those. I'm going places that I would not.
I hear you, Pastor.
I looked in the bathroom, she looked, she said, you know, this register is old, this is, don't look good. I think the register's been working good for us. I'm like, Dad, we don't need no register.
Stop.
But because I know that mama ain't happy,
nobody,
nobody happy.
Amen.
You know, even the ants around the house say, man, you better go to the Lord. They're all everybody. So I went to Lowe's and I got a register. I brought it back home. We couldn't get the register.
Wrong side.
I brought it. We brought two sides. Say, just in case the one not right, the other one. So she's trying to figure out how we're going to get this thing up. I'm getting it. I grabbed the thing, just pulled it out. It came up. And I put the other one in. It looks good. I have to admit, I didn't want to admit it when she asked me. She asked me. Went in the bathroom, the toilet seat needed to be changed. The drone's been working. Things, I mean things that we've taken for granted that, you know, it's, I've been in the yard, y'all, I've been working like a Hebrew slave. All because the kids come and the grandkids come and she wants everything. So listen, when y'all think about Pastor in these coming days and weeks, you don't even have to know why.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm going there.
There's some places I would not go. And do things that I would have put off.
Amen.
And I'm going to do them because I believe God is in it. God's frequency and march at his command.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And here's another thing. God not only wants to order your steps, but he also wants to order your stops.
Right.
Amen. Amen. Not just where you go, but sometimes God will tell you where not to go.
Amen.
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 That's true. Amen.
Amen.
I'm glad that God tells me where not to go. So, you know, I in the past, I'm going to just tell y'all, this is a personal testimony. In the past, when I was growing up and, you know, I was trying to do, you know, be a Christian young man or whatever, but there were times when I looked for trouble. I wanted to be in trouble. Because, like all the other teenagers, I wanted to be like them. I wanted to find the part. And God, will you let me find it? You know what's frustrating? When you try to find trouble that you know you shouldn't be in, and God won't even let you find it. Yeah. Then when you find the party and you get there, God will always have somebody there say, this ain't it's a conspiracy. I'm trying to tell you, God will keep you when you don't even want to keep yourself.
Praise God. Yes.
Amen.
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 That's what God we serve.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.